Welcome to Re'eh Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures. Breakfast one morning in the early summer, and Irving asked Rivka if she'd seen his newspaper. Rivka said, Dad, newspapers are old school. People use tablets nowadays. And she handed Irving her iPad. And you know, that annoying fly didn't stand a chance. They're getting it. Wow. So this week's portion or parsha in the Torah is called Acharei Mot, after the death. So it's a pretty serious name, but it's after the death of Aaron's sons because they offered unauthorized fire to the Lord. And it's a very, actually these two portions are very, very significant. Leviticus chapter 16 through 18 is this portion. And in 16, it's the instructions for the high priest, for the Kohen HaGadol, for Yom Kippur. Very, very significant. And then in chapter 17 is equally significant, the prohibition against eating blood and this declaration that it's only the blood that can make atonement for sin. And without the blood, there's no atonement. So really powerful. And then chapter 18 has laws forbidding incest, adultery, homosexuality, bestiality, and child sacrifice. So pretty heavy section. And I was reading through it, and these two verses 8 and 16 of Leviticus 18, just jumped out at me. You'll see the reason why as we get into this. But I'm going to read to you verse 8 first, and then verse 16. So verse 8 says, Aravat, the nakedness, Eshet, Avicha, of the wife of your father, lo tigale, you shall not uncover. Aravat, the nakedness, avicha hiv, it is your father's nakedness. And then down a little bit further in verse 16, aravat eshet achicha, the nakedness of the wife of your brother, lo tigale, you shall not uncover. Aravat achikat hi, it is your brother's nakedness. So those are kind of strange verses to start out a message with, right? What is this all about? This is saying you're not to have sexual relations, first of all, with your stepmother. There's another one that says with your mother. But this is, let's say your father gets remarried after your mother dies. You're not to have sexual relations with your stepmother. But what struck me was the reason. It would uncover your father's nakedness. Now that phrase, that's a phrase meaning it would shame him. Because all through the Bible, you know, if you're uncovered, you're shamed. Not because it would hurt or shame your stepmother, but because it would uncover your father's nakedness. It would shame him. And I believe that's because in the Bible there's so much about authority. And your father is the authority in your family. So you would shame the person in authority in your family, and we'll see why that is a big thing. And similarly concerning your brother. Your brother is the head of his family, and if you were to have sexual relations with your brother's wife, your sister-in-law, that would shame him, the exact same phrasing. So what struck me about this was that the Bible greatly emphasizes respect for authority. And those of you who are part of our leadership here have been participating in a course about godly authority for about the past 8 months now. It's called Undercover, and it's a teaching by John Bevere. This is the book that goes along with the course, and Pastor Tom has been facilitating it And we've been watching once a month a video, reading a chapter in the book, and discussing it, and going through it through the workbook. And I highly recommend this course. We're hoping to offer it to everyone when the leadership finishes, which will be about a few months from now. So we've been going through this course, and the Sunday before, the video brought us all to a place of deep conviction and repentance on a subject that is very current and very relevant to all of us. So as I was praying about what to share, the Ruach, the Holy Spirit, directed me to share what that was all about for the rest of the congregation, because I'm sure that many of us and many of you have gone down the same road and struggle with the same thing. So first I want to apologize to the leaders who saw John Bevere present this. I think it's probably okay if you hear it again, though, because it was so good. Do you guys agree? It was so amazing to hear this. And it's going to be obviously a little bit different. I'm not John Bevere, and it'll be, you know, with a little bit different emphasis on this. Now, the whole idea here of the book title, because when people first look at this, they think, what does that mean? You're in hiding? Undercover? That's not it. It's referring to being under the covering of God's authority. And when you're under his covering, we know there is protection, blessing, and guidance, all of the blessings of God, grace of God. But when you're not under his covering, you're in danger. We are in danger. You're in danger from Hasatan, Satan. You're in danger from temptation, and you're in danger from your own flesh when you're not under his covering. So as Pastor Tom knows, when he was the one who suggested that we do this course, I struggled with doing it or leading it because I am in a position of authority here, and I didn't want my leading that course or my teaching on this to be interpreted as my attempting to force my authority on anyone or demand submission and obedience from people. So that's why Tom is actually leading the course, and I'm just taking it like everybody else. But for this Shabbat, even though I kind of brought to the Lord that same struggle about speaking about this, the Holy Spirit just kept directing me to share what we learned because I believe it will be a breakthrough for all of you that hear this today. So I can't cover all that John Bevere had covered because there's 11 chapters that we've read and there's 7 videos that we've watched. But I'm just going to focus on one subject. And I think it's an amazing thing that I've never heard anybody teach on before, but it's very real. It's the difference between submission and obedience. I'll say it again, the difference between submission and obedience, okay? So we're going to start out with Romans chapter 13 and verse 1. It says this, "Let every person submit himself to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist are put in place by God." Now, most people have real difficulty accepting this verse. I did. Absolutely. It says that all authority is established by God, even those evil authorities that we have seen. Now, in the Bible, we have some good examples of this that we can kind of wrap our heads around. God used evil rulers to bring judgment, like Nebuchadnezzar brought judgment on Israel when Israel was in great sin and destroyed Israel. And he used an evil rule of Pharaoh to demonstrate his power to the Egyptians and the Israelites and the rest of the world, right? He put them in place. He says that. But it's hard to accept this when history records so many evil people in positions of authority, especially in governments, even in our own lifetimes, like Hitler and Stalin and the Islamic State. But this understanding of God's role in establishing authority is critical for all of us. Neither John Bevere or I made this up. Okay? The Holy Spirit inspired it. Rabbi Shaul or Paul wrote it, and it's in the scripture. And it says, those that exist are put in place by God. So, the reason I believe that most people find this verse difficult is because they don't understand what the Bible means by submit. Okay? Remember, we're going to talk about the difference between submission and obedience. So, in this verse, the word that is translated submit is the Greek word upotasso. And if you go look it up in the concordance, you'll find that it also means to respect. OK? Okay, so it could have been chosen to be translated as respect government authority, but most translations say submit, and that's where the confusion comes in. So this is important because, you see, if God put every authority in place, to not respect that authority would be disrespecting God. You see that? So that's very significant. But immediately, all of your minds are probably rushing right now to the thought, because that's where mine went, is, that mean I have to obey evil authorities? That's what I thought. How many of you thought that right away? That's what we're going to look at here, and we get further clarity from this on a verse in the book of Hebrews from the author of Hebrews. The context in this verse is about Messiah's body, and it's chapter 13, verse 17. And it says this, "Obey those who rule over you and be submissive, for they watch out for your souls as those who must give an account. Let them do so with joy and not with grief, for that would be unprofitable for you." Now, in this verse, submissive is a translation of another Greek word, upekate, and obey is a very different Greek word, pitheste, very different words. And, you know, this is something that I find I'm prone to do, and I suspect other people who do are prone to it too. You're reading the Bible, and you see that the author has used two descriptive words about something, and you kind of think they mean the same thing. But when the Holy Spirit uses two different words, he has a purpose in doing that. They have two different meanings. So it's always good to do a little study on what are the real meanings of these words to make sure that even the translators have got it right. So in this case, in this verse, we have two words, submissive and obey, right? Obey those who rule over you, be submissive. Okay. Now, we all know what obey means, right? Everybody, do what you're told, right? No question about that. We should understand that the two words in one sentence, being used in one sentence, means submit does not necessarily have the same meaning as obey. See that? So what does it mean? Well, we looked it up. It means respect. It could mean obey, but it also could mean honor or respect. And if the author of Hebrews here used the word for obey, and then he used another word, you would say, well, he doesn't mean obey, or he'd just be repeating himself. He must mean something else in this verse. So the word submissive here, I believe, means to honor and respect. We are to honor and respect our leaders in the body, and we are to obey them. Because, presumably, these leaders in Messiah's body are not evil people. Now, we're going to discuss later some exceptions to the commands to obey leaders in the body who require you to do something against God's word, because that's probably jumping to your mind right away, too. So we're going to get to that, too. Now, let me just give a little caveat here. I am not teaching this about this because I have felt disrespected by any of you, okay? So ease your mind. If anyone has disrespected me behind my back, I'm not aware of it. You may be aware of it, but I'm not aware of it, okay? I'm teaching on this because disrespect of authority is rampant in our culture. Everybody realize that? At every level of our culture. Every level. And Hebrews 13:70 ends by saying it would be unprofitable to you. That's kind of a mild term. But it could be understood to be this. If you do not submit and respect authority in Messiah's body, it can also be ruinous, detrimental. If you look up the Greek word, this is a different Greek word, allocitales. And if you look that up, it could be unprofitable, but also ruinous and detrimental to you. So, in fact, it is unprofitable to you to disrespect authority, even if you obey authority. How many here have ever obeyed something but disrespected the person who told you to do it? Sure. That would be obedience with an ungodly attitude. And John Bevere does a whole message, a whole half hour or 40 minutes on that. I'm not going to go that far on it, but that would also be there. So there's a warning here that it's bad for us. We could suffer if we disrespect authority. Disrespecting authority, very simply, moves you out from under the covering of God's authority because you're disrespecting God who established that authority. You follow what I'm saying? If God put this person in authority and you disrespect that person, you are also disrespecting the person who put him in, or the person, the God who put that person into that position. So it moves you out from under God's covering, and it opens the door for Satan to attack you, bring destruction, bring torment. This could manifest in many ways. It could be sickness. It could be a very common one is you getting in trouble with authority. Refuse to respect authority, and somehow you mess up and you're under some trouble with authority. Other people, particularly children, may not submit to your authority because you're disrespecting authority. You follow that? All of those things can happen. And then this is another verse that's very important, 1 Samuel 15:23, where the prophet Samuel says, for rebellion, which is disrespecting authority, is like what? Sorcery, stubbornness like the crime of idolatry. So the disrespect of authority is rebellion, which is sorcery, witchcraft, divination, all of those kind of things. So the occult, demonic attacks of oppression could be the result of disrespecting authority. Everybody follow that? So it's pretty serious. So let's apply this understanding of the meaning of submit to Romans chapter 13, verse 1, which is where we started. So we're going to repeat the verse up here. Let every person submit himself to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist are put in place by God. Now, from the context, Rabbi Shaul, Paul, is clearly talking about governmental authorities here. And first thing we know is that in his time, the governmental authority was the ungodly, evil Roman Empire that persecuted believers. And yet he's saying, we must submit to that authority. And also in this verse, only the word submit is used. It's a different Greek word, but it's submit. It's upotasso, and it means submit. Obey is not used in this verse. Anybody see obey up there? Not there. So the Bible teaches we are always to submit in the sense of honoring and respecting authority in our lives because they're put there by God. But, and this has probably come to your mind already, the Bible also teaches with many examples that we are not to obey authorities when they command us to do things contrary to God's word, right? Things that are sinful or things that are evil, or even to ignore sinful or evil things that they're doing or the other people that they're telling to do. And there are many examples of this, but let me just bring one to mind from, you know, which we were celebrating Passover, the midwives. Remember the midwives in the Passover story? What did they do? They refused to obey Pharaoh. And what happened? God blessed them because Pharaoh was telling them to murder the infant sons of the Israelites, which was wrong. They refused and they prospered. So let's just look at a couple of examples of this. Daniel had three friends who were taken with him as captives to Babylon when Babylon destroyed Israel. And the king of Babylon called them before him. And in Daniel chapter 3 and verse 14, we read this. Nebuchadnezzar responded to them, to the three friends, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you don't serve my gods or worship the golden image that I set up? Verse 15. Now, if you are ready, at the moment you hear the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, and pipes, and all kinds of music, you must fall down and worship the image that I have made. But if you do not worship, you will immediately be thrown into the midst of a furnace of blazing fire. Then what God will be able to deliver you out of my hands? Verse 16, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, saying, O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to answer you concerning this matter. Verse 17, if it is so, our God, whom we serve, is able to save us from the furnace of blazing fire, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. Verse 18, yet even if he does not, let it be known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods, nor worship the golden image that you set up. So they're blatantly saying, we are not going to obey. But notice, they're saying it respectfully, right? They're refusing to obey. So the king had the furnace heated up, especially hot, and throw them in. And here's an artist's rendition of what happened. And the king, down in verse 25, says, look, I see four men walking about unbound and unharmed in the middle of the fire. And the fourth has the appearance like a son of the gods. I believe this is a pre-incarnation manifestation of Yeshua, the Messiah, called a theophany is what it's called. He was in the furnace with the men. And the three came out of the furnace. Doesn't say the fourth came out. We don't know what happened to the fourth. They came out alive, unburned, and their clothing was not even charred. And in verse 28, Nebuchadnezzar exclaimed, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him. They defied the king's edict and gave up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own God." Verse 29, "Therefore, I hereby decree that any people, nation, or language that says anything slanderous against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego will be torn limb from limb and their house made a pile of rubble, because there is no other God that is able to deliver in this way." So God used Daniel's friends to change the heart of King Nebuchadnezzar. It didn't change it that much. He still wanted to pull people limb from limb and tear down their houses. But he changed his heart about who his God was, for sure. And this happened because they disobeyed him, but they were respectful. They didn't rail against him and say, "You idol-worshiping idiot, how can you worship a statue?" So the king's chart, I believe, would not have changed if these men had railed against the king. So that's very clear example in the Tanakh. But then in the New Covenant, the apostles prayed for a crippled man who was miraculously healed. And a crowd gathered, and they told the people the healing was done in Yeshua's name. So they were called before the governmental authorities, the Sanhedrin, put into place by God. In Acts chapter 4, verse 18, "So they called them in again and ordered them under no circumstances to speak or teach in the name of Yeshua." Verse 19, "But Kepha, Peter, and Yochanan," it's John, "answered, 'You must judge whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than God.'" Verse 20, "As for us, we can't help talking about what we have actually seen and heard." They refused to obey the authorities, the Sanhedrin. They refused to stop speaking about Yeshua. But notice again, they also spoke respectfully to the Sanhedrin. Verse 21, "They threatened them with some more, but finally let them go. They couldn't punish them because of the people, for everyone was praising God over what had happened, the miraculous healing. Since the man who had been miraculously healed was more than 40 years old." Verse 23, "Upon being released, they went back to their friends and reported what the head Kohanim, the priests, and the elders had said to them." Verse 24, "When they heard it, they raised their voices to God with singleness of heart. 'Master,' they prayed, 'you made the heaven, earth, the sea, and everything in them.'" And then they praised God a little bit more. In verse 29, "So now, Lord, take note of their threats and enable your slaves to speak your message with boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and to do signs and miracles through the name of your holy servant, Yeshua." And while they were still praying, verse 31, "The place where they were gathered was shaken, and they were all filled with the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, and they spoke God's message with boldness." You can applaud. You can applaud them, absolutely. So the rest of the disciples, not just Peter and John, they also refused to obey. And notice that they didn't pray for an end to persecution. They prayed for boldness and more miracles. And God answered by shaking the place. They didn't even pray that God would spare them from potential punishment that they might experience from the authorities. And there are many other examples of believers refusing to obey authorities who command them to do things contrary to God's word. But if you study them, and I never saw this before we had this teaching, you'll find that they disobeyed the people in authority in a respectful way. That's what the word submitted means. They simply respected those who were in authority. Other examples of this are David. As you know, he was being chased by Saul, and Saul was telling him to stay right here so I can kill you. David didn't obey that. He got out of town. But he was respectful of Saul. Remember when he cut off the hem of his robe? And then he felt bad because he had touched the Lord's anointing. I mean, David was amazing at this attitude of respect for because Saul was the anointed one. Saul was the one God had put in that place. And David would not remove him. But also, we see Paul in the book of Acts before the Sanhedrin, again respecting authority. And Yeshua himself, he submitted to being tried by the Sanhedrin. He could have just walked away. He could have said the word and they would all fallen over and just lay there. But he disobeyed them by refusing to deny that he was the Son of God. They said to him, deny that you're the Son of God. That's blasphemy. He refused to do that. And if you think about some of the other things he did, sometimes he spoke against his persecutors, saying, "Woe unto you." But if you look at it, he was speaking the truth and giving them a warning. He wasn't railing against them. And that railing against people, that brought me to a passage in Jude that many of you are familiar with. And this understanding will clear up that passage, because many of you have confusion about this passage. I did. Jude is writing about ungodly people. And in verse 8, he says this: "Likewise, these people with their visions defile their own flesh, despise godly authority, and insult angelic beings." Verse 9, "When Michael, one of the ruling angels, took issue with the adversary," that's Satan, "arguing over the body of Moses, he did not dare bring against him an insulting charge," other translation says a railing accusation, "but said, 'May Adonai, the Lord, rebuke you.'" Now this, follow me here, because this is important to understand. Michael said to Satan, "May the Lord rebuke you," because Michael did not have authority over Satan. Okay? They were both angelic beings. Okay? So he said, "The Lord rebuke you." And we're going to see that that's very important for us. In verse 10, "However, these people insult anything they don't understand, and what they do understand naturally without thinking like animals. By these things they are destroyed." So here's the thing. Jude is not saying we should not speak about or to Satan in Jude is saying we should not even speak about or to Satan in a disrespectful way. You grasp that? That's what he's saying. He's not saying we should refrain from spiritual warfare in here. And he's simply saying that our spiritual warfare should be done with respect even for Satan and his demons, because God created them and he put them in a position of authority. Now you're looking at me like, what? God put them in a position of authority. They had authority once over all humanity. Adam and Eve gave it to them, but Yeshua said in Luke chapter 10, 19, "Remember, I have given you authority so you can trample down snakes and scorpions and beat all the enemy's forces so that you will remain completely unharmed." So Yeshua took away Satan's authority over believers, not unbelievers. So Satan still has authority over unbelievers. You have authority over Satan that Michael, the angel, did not have. Can you grasp that? You have that. So my understanding of Jude is that not that we should deal with Satan saying, "May the Lord rebuke you," because Yeshua gave you and I authority to command him directly. You see that? But that when we address Satan with authority over him that we've been given, we should speak respectfully even to him, which is a challenge. Okay? And his demons, absolutely, right? And people that are being used by Satan, right? So I believe we're supposed to apply this understanding to all areas of authority in our lives. We must respect and honor parents, teachers, coaches, employers, bosses, police. Okay, here's the hard one: government officials. In almost all circumstances, we're to also to obey them. But when they tell us to do something that contradicts God's written word, we must respectfully refuse to obey. And as Daniel's friend said, we should refuse to obey even if God chooses not to rescue us from the consequences of our disobedience. Hebrews 11 is the hall of faith, the hall of fame of faith, and it speaks about those who had great faith, obeyed God rather than men, but were persecuted even to the death. And in the early days of the body of Messiah, many chose martyrdom over denying the Lord. That was a direct application of this principle. They refused to obey the Roman authorities and deny the Lord and worship Caesar or the Roman gods, and they knew the penalty for that was death, and God did not rescue many of them. And you know what? It's happening today. Everybody aware it's happening today in parts of the world? Believers are being persecuted by radical jihadists, and they are refusing to deny Yeshua, and they are being killed, executed. So this is pretty heavy stuff. Pretty heavy stuff here. There's a couple of other things that are probably coming into your mind, so about applications of this. We'll get to them. Be patient with me. Here's a very interesting application of this understanding of the word submit, that it means respect or honor. Ephesians 5, verse 21, submit to one another in fear of the Messiah. If you believe that submit means obey, this makes no sense, right? How can I obey you and you obey me at the same time? If I'm saying do A and you're saying do B, how can that make any sense if we have to obey each other? You see what I'm saying? But if submit means respect, makes perfect sense. We're supposed to respect each other, right? Honor each other. So you are hereby freed, if you believe that verse meant that you had to obey every believer that told you to do something. You are hereby set free from that. You don't have to obey. You have to respect. Okay? And you can say, I respectfully disagree with you, and I'm not going to do that. Okay. Now, this is particularly applicable to marriage, since actually that verse is the beginning of a whole passage on marriage. It's all about marriage. So let's just read on and see how what happens when we apply this meaning of submit. Verse 22, wives should submit to their husbands as they do the Lord. Okay. Simply means wives should respect their husbands, honor their husbands. And this clears up the confusion, because in the next verse, it says, verse 23, the husband is the head of the wife, as Messiah, as the head of the Messianic community, is himself the one who keeps the body safe. And I'm going to read a couple more. Just as the Messianic community submits to the Messiah, so also wives should submit, respect their husbands in everything. As for you husbands, love your wives, just as the Messiah loved the Messianic community and Dave gave himself up for his behalf. So husbands, it said right in verse 23, is the head of their families, meaning God holds husbands or fathers responsible for all that happens in their family. And wives should respect their husbands. But wives are not required to obey their husbands if they are told to do something that is against the written word of God. Okay? But also husbands must submit to their wives. We read that in verse 21, right? Submit to one another, right? Meaning respect and honor your wife as a husband. And that includes meeting their needs, taking their opinions seriously, loving them as Messiah loves his body, laying down your life for them. So you can see this sets up a whole different dynamic than you might have thought if it was submit to one another means nobody is in charge. Or the other way this is interpreted is that the husband is the boss and he just runs everything. It's very different. Now, this understanding also gives us clarity on how to handle a government that is doing evil, like the Nazis, let's say. When the government commands us to do evil or to tolerate the evil it does, we must be like those who disobeyed. We must be like the Jews who fought in the Warsaw Ghetto, the Jews and Gentiles who fought the Nazis in the underground during World War II, and the Gentiles who rescued Jews from the Nazis. But we should not be disrespectful, even of our enemies, this is saying. Now, if you're aware of some of the things that have happened in our country over the last 60 or so years, these principles were followed at the beginning of the civil rights movement. It was nonviolent, and people were respectful, if you remember some of those demonstrations. And it was also what was followed at the beginning of the pro-life movement. People were nonviolent and were respectful. But there were times, especially when the Black Panthers took over the civil rights movement, that it changed, right, to violence. It changed greatly, and the respect went away. And that's also happened at times in the pro-life movement, not always. And that is usually the sign of defeat. That means it won't work if that's what carries on. The shooting of abortion providers in the pro-life movement, that's just the opposite of that. And also, in general, we can see our nation going down this road over the past year and a half in spades, right? The hatred of our president has been clearly disrespectful. It's a degree that I've never seen before in my lifetime, and I go back pretty far. I've never seen political opponents rail against each other and sling mud at each other and slander each other in the ways that this happens. If you tune into some of the interview shows, I don't watch them anymore because people are just shouting at each other. and they're just being disrespectful to each other. I can't watch it. Now, please understand that all of this does not mean we can't criticize, correct, and reveal the truth to those in authority or about authority. It just means we're supposed to do it respectfully. And that's a witness, that we're doing it respectfully. Now, the Bible also says we should submit and respect godly authority in the body. That is, rabbis, pastors, elders, ministry leaders. But, again, believers are not required to obey a person in authority in the body if and do something against the word of God. Now, that disobedience shouldn't happen if you just disagree with what you've been told should be done by the person who's in charge of that task, or you think you have a better idea, or you've had some negative experience. But if it's against God's commands, you should respectfully say, I'm not going to do that. What else you should do in addition to disobeying? Pray. And we've talked about this before. Confront that person. Confront that person in a loving way, according to Matthew 18. You know the process of Matthew 18. Go alone. If you don't receive it, take somebody with you. If it doesn't receive that, then bring it to the elders. All of those ways, but do it in a respectful way. So, when I read John Bevere's teaching on this just 2 weeks ago, this command to respect authority became very real to me concerning respecting and honoring governmental authority. I was heavily convicted that I have not obeyed that command. I've disobeyed it many, many times, especially during the Obama years. And before that, the Clinton years. And I know you who are laughing are saying, yeah, I've done that too, right? The Clinton years, and I go way back to the Nixon years and the Johnson years. Anybody here go back to disrespecting them? Tricky Dick, right? What's that all about? Concerning what was going on in Vietnam. And I even go way back to Eisenhower, because my parents were staunch Democrats, and we had some choice names for Eisenhower. And I remembered all these derogatory names that I actually spoke about our presidents. And I was very convicted. Vice presidents, others in government, right down to town government leaders, governors, mayors. Not that they didn't have their faults. See, that's not the thing. But God's word commands us to be respectful because they are in authority. I was also convicted about disrespecting my parents, big time on that. Teachers, bosses. I gave several teachers lots of gray hairs in my career in school. So in preparing today, I was also convicted about disrespecting angelic beings, Satan. I've spoken disrespectfully many times. How many of you have spoken disrespectfully towards Satan? Let's see. Be honest. Be honest. So last Sunday, or the Sunday before last, after I understood what the Bible teaches about respecting authority, I repented publicly before the leaders here. Remember, guys? Then we watched the video, and after watching the video, all of the leaders also repented publicly of this. We went around. This was very unusual, right? We ran around, and every person spoke out, Lord, forgive me, I have disrespected authority. So that's the reason the Lord led me to speak about this today. I know many of you have disobeyed this command to respect authority concerning our government, our president, perhaps other authorities, parents, teachers, coaches, bosses, pastors, rabbis, Satan and demons. And that has left you open to experiencing things that are unprofitable in your life. Detrimental, ruinous even, out from under God's covering. So we're going to end up with a little bit of prayer here over these things. Everybody ready for that? Okay, and just pray with me here. And Lord, your ways are not our ways. This is a real wake-up call to the fact that you don't think like we think. You have placed people in authority, and you expect us to respect them because you put them there. Help us to receive what your word says about that. That is really hard. And I just pray right now for myself, And for everybody here who's struggling with that statement, that all people in authority are placed there by God, I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would just work in us so that we would be able to receive that because it's in your word. So, Father, we recognize that we have disrespected those in authority. Government officials, police, parents, teachers, employers, pastors, rabbis, elders, ministry leaders, even Satan and his demons. How many here just acknowledge to God right now, you recognize you have fallen into these traps? Just raise your hand to the Lord right now. You don't need to look up, but I can tell you just about everybody has their hand up. You're not alone. You're not alone. This is so common in our culture. It's actually taught by our culture. Because we look at the news, we watch our leaders, and what do? They disrespect authority, so it's just, it's communicated to us, right? So we recognize we've done this, Father. We take responsibility for falling into this trap. It's a trap of the enemy. It's a temptation of the enemy because it gives him power over us. And ignorance is no excuse. He gets that power, whether you understood this or not. He gets that power when we do this. So we take responsibility for falling into this temptation. And now, Father, before you, we repent. Just in your own words, just tell the Lord you're sorry for disrespecting authority. Governmental authority, parents, teachers, employers, pastors, rabbis, elders, ministry leaders, and spirit beings. Lord, we ask you to forgive us where we have disrespected them. In the name of Yeshua, we ask you to forgive us, O Lord. We recognize that it's only because of your sacrifice that we can be forgiven. And so we ask your forgiveness now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. And Father, we receive your forgiveness. Thank you that your word says that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So we receive your forgiveness right now, Lord. And we renounce, just say these along with me, we renounce disrespect, rebellion, division, sorcery, divination, witchcraft, idolatry, spirits of rebellion, we remove you right now. Spirits of disrespect, we command you to leave in the name of Yeshua, respectfully. Spirits of division, we command you to leave. Divination, witchcraft and idolatry, I command you, we agree that these spirits are to leave us right now in the name of Yeshua. Any other spirit that comes to your mind that might have access to you because of this, you just speak it out right now. Because it might be for somebody else. Any other spirits that anybody's getting any discernment on? Spirit of what? Hatred. In the name of Yeshua, we come against hatred. Division, fear, in the name of Yeshua, we break the power of fear. Lying, what was that? Bitterness, in the name of Yeshua, we break the power of bitterness and all that goes with bitterness. In the name of Yeshua, we break that power. Lust, self-exaltation, we break that power in the name of Yeshua. Complaining, lawlessness, that's a big one. Mockery. We break the power of these spirits that may have gained access over us because of this. We break their power right now in the name of Yeshua. Judgment, condemnation, shame, and guilt in the name of Yeshua. We break those spirits' power. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And Father, we pray now. We ask for your healing touch on anything that has been harmed in our bodies and our minds and our emotions, in our souls, anything that has been harmed by this situation and by these spirits, we ask for your healing touch right now upon us for that. Anything that has been harmed by our disrespect for authority. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And Father, we know you warned us that these things would try to get back at us. So we pray for the gift of discerning of spirits to catch them as they're trying and to resist their return. To have the wisdom to resist their return. We ask, Father, that you renew our minds so that we would think in respectful ways and not disrespectful ways of our brothers and sisters who are made in your image, We should respect each other because we're made in your image. And the authorities, all of those things, Lord, renew our minds, refill us with your Holy Spirit, oh God. Fill us where, if we think of those things being cast out, all that empty space, just fill us with your Ruach, Lord, with your Spirit. Fill us up with your Spirit. And we thank you. We rejoice in your deliverance today. And we believe there's going to be breakthroughs, breakthroughs. Thank you in the name that is above every name, at which every knee must bow, in the name of Yeshua. Amen and amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. Call our office to request a copy on videotape. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670, or you can write us at 1326 North Whitten Road, Rochester, New York, 14609, or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service, Saturday mornings at 10 a.m., Complete Children's Program Interpretation for the Deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. We hope you'll visit a featuring Messianic Jewish bookstore located in the lobby of Shema Yisrael. Call for hours. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bengals and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick, Sundays from 2 to 3 p.m. on WRCI 102.7 FM. You can also hear Bagels and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bagelsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Re'eh Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the Scriptures.